We're thrilled to have such a large audience, and also delighted that we have these experts in the field of medicine, REI, reproductive laws in Illinois, in the States in general, and also in Canada, focusing on different aspects of surrogacy, medical and legal. So Victor Ferrara, as you know, is a well-known person to us, a dear friend. And Vicky was going to discuss with us the legal consideration for effective contracts, insurance, and security partnership rights. And I have a few questions pertaining to legal constraints for surrogacy and gay parental rights in various jurisdictions within the states. So Vicky, if you can elaborate a little bit on that.
Sure. Well, again, it's good to be here. And the legalities of surrogacy are really important, paramount, of course, and you need to be in the hands of competent lawyers who practice in the field of assisted reproductive technology law. And every state has different practitioners, so you can find really good lawyers. There are some here today, and we belong to organizations where you can find lawyers. So, for example, I'm from Connecticut. I practice in the states of Connecticut and New York. So I'm very, very familiar with Connecticut procedure, and I'm familiar with other states' procedures as well, just because of doing surrogacy. But whenever I have a surrogacy journey through my agency going on in a different state, like for example, Florida or Illinois or Idaho, I make sure to have a lawyer in that state who will help with the legal issues regarding parentage. So in terms of the legalities, what you need to be, what you need to have in mind, there are certain steps. So one is the contract. You're going to have a contract with your surrogate. And prior to the contract, really one of the most important considerations that your agency will do for you will be to make the right match. So what has to go into the contract are things like, if you want to have a termination of the pregnancy for a birth defect, then you must be matched with a surrogate who philosophically will agree with that and will do that for you upon your request. So we would never make a match with someone who wouldn't want to have a termination of pregnancy with someone who would. And similar to selective reduction, sometimes an embryo divides. Sometimes you put two embryos in, and we've had two different situations where an embryo divided. It became triplets, and it became a high-risk pregnancy, which I'm sure the doctors will speak to. But you need to, if you think you need to have a selective reduction, or if the high-risk doctor says there needs to be a selective reduction, then we need to have a surrogate who has no moral or philosophical reservations regarding that. So the initial match is really important. But we are going to get you into a contract with your surrogate. It's going to be like many pages long, 30 to 40 pages long, with all kinds of rights and obligations that everyone has. So you have to have a lawyer who's going to explain that to you and draft that for you. And then you need to have, the surrogate will also have a lawyer who will explain it and review it for her. So everyone is represented by counsel, and that's a hugely important thing in surrogacy, so that everyone is really taken care of legally. And that's what makes surrogacy in the United States really work well, is because of the ethical considerations that we as lawyers have in making the legalities happen properly and correctly and managed in that way. So then you have a contract, then you're all going to move toward the embryo transfer. And once there's a pregnancy, then of course we have another major legal issue that we have to address, and that is making sure that you become legal parents of your baby. And it suffice to say, because I have a list of things I'm supposed to go over, but I could never do it in 6 to 7 minutes, probably not even in 6 to 7 hours. But you suffice to say that every state in the U.S. has different procedures for establishing legal parentage. Some states require court proceedings, some states require paperwork. In Connecticut, we require a court proceeding, but we have very, very good law in Connecticut. And in fact, it was my case. We have a Connecticut Supreme Court case that states that any intended parent to a valid gestational agreement can become the legal parent prior to the birth. It doesn't matter if you're married or unmarried, gay or straight, or even if you're genetically related to the fetus to be, the baby to be born. So if you've used an egg donor, if only one of you is the genetic parent, the other non-genetic parent in Connecticut can still become the legal parent prior to the birth. So we really love that. I mean, there are some situations where we look for a post-birth order, but those may be more for international clients. But for you, if you live in the US, to have a pre-birth order where when you go to the hospital, you're both looked at as the legal parents of this baby, everyone sees you as that, because we make sure that the hospital knows, we make sure that the State Department of Vital Records knows. You have the court order in hand when you go to the hospital, and no one questions whatsoever that you're going to be the ones to make medical decisions for your baby, and you're going to be the ones to take the baby home from the hospital. This is crucial, and this is what your lawyer will make sure to have happen, and your agency will make sure to have happen, that during the pregnancy, this is being managed. You should not be left out to figure this out for yourself. It's too complicated. You will have help. You will have a lawyer. You will have, if you choose to work with an agency, you will have the agency people making sure that this is going to happen for you. It's really one of, obviously, the, besides the contract, one of the most important aspects of your surrogacy journey. You will also hear that you may need to do a second parent adoption after you have your birth order, even if you're named as the two legal parents. So again, this is going to be by state to state, and you're going to have legal help to ferret this out. But because of the fact that we're gay and our marriages are not recognized throughout the entire world, we need to maybe still do a second parent adoption. So you may be advised to go back to your home state, and the non-genetic parent should still do a second parent adoption. Don't fret. These are legal procedures that can be done. And if your lawyer advises you to do that, just pay attention and do it. It won't, you've already paid a lot of money for all of this to pay another, whatever it might be, to make sure that this legal piece is put in place. Follow the advice of your lawyers. It's just so important to stabilize your family.
Vicky, if you can finally say a few words, because I know as an obstetrician, there's no more of a headache than HMOs, PPOs, and insurance issues, which of course I've lived as a patient of myself and for my baby. So can you say a few words about insurance issues and coverage?
Yeah, it's a very, very difficult topic to just say a few words about. It's one of the hottest, trickiest issues in surrogacy. And you will have lengthy conversations with your lawyers about this issue. What you want to know is that somebody's looking out for you regarding insurance, and that should be a lawyer, or there are certain companies that will do insurance reviews, particularly for surrogacy. But you can find out who these people are. But like, for example, in our agency, and many of the agencies, I know Steve Snyder is here, and he does it with his agency, IARC, we review insurance policies, and we tell you whether it will cover maternity or if there's a surrogacy exclusion. No one can really guarantee insurance coverage. I mean, if someone does, that would be great. But I know for us, because I'm not the insurance company and I'm not privy to changes made in insurance policies, which changes are made all the time, that we can't guarantee it, but we can give you very good information on which you can make informed decisions. So, does the surrogate have insurance? Does it cover maternity? Does it have a surrogacy exclusion? These are questions that can be answered and should be answered. And then you can decide, and we can decide together, whether you should use your surrogate's insurance policy for the maternity and the pregnancy, or whether we should be looking into another policy. Perhaps the surrogate should get a policy through the Affordable Care Act. And that's endearingly known as Obamacare. So sometimes we have to look to those policies. Some of those have surrogacy exclusions too. So you still need to review the policies. You still need to make sure that there's maternity and it will cover. But again, it's a really complicated issue and you need advice and guidance on that issue. With newborn, you're in good shape because presumably you have your own medical insurance and you'll put your baby on your newborn on your policy, and that's a very good thing. That's something that our international clients are always wrestling with. They have difficult issues with the newborn insurance, but again, you need advice. You need to get information, and you need to have to make informed decisions.
Thank you, Vicky. I always say that insurance, when it covers an HMO, is like a box of chocolate. You never know how much and if whatever service is covered. It's kind of a headache, and unfortunately, I don't think it's getting any easier.
Let me just add one thing to that, too. When the surrogate has maternity insurance, you don't use it. We don't use it for the IVF clinic. And you'll ask why. It's because she's not being treated for infertility, so we don't want her to be using her insurance policy for any infertility procedures at an infertility clinic. So you're only going to use that policy for the pregnancy, and you must realize that her treatment at the IVF clinic will be paid for out of pocket by you.
Thank you. Next, I will introduce Heather Ross, who's from Illinois, from the practice here. And I'm very proud that we have somebody from Illinois, and I'm from Illinois because my last child, Noah, was born right here, and I really had a wonderful experience.
Thank you.
Heather, if you could ask you to maybe concentrate on what makes Illinois so surrogacy friendly and the process of establishing parenthood here in Illinois.
Sure. So Illinois is really a unique state in that we're one of the only states in the country where there's no necessity for court involvement at all. We have a statute that was passed, about 11 years ago. And basically what it says is if you comply with all of the requirements, and there are a lot of strict requirements, which is, again, I want to reiterate how important it is to work with an attorney in the state where your parentage will come about. You want to make sure you're working with someone either licensed in that state or who is working with someone else licensed in that state. And someone that is knowledgeable in this field of surrogacy. So at any rate, here in Illinois, at the time of birth, your names go on the birth certificate immediately. There's never a need to go to court to get a pre-birth order or a post-birth order. Now, there are several requirements imposed by our statute, and these are strict requirements. So if you don't meet all of them, you can't take use of this friendly statute we have. Your attorney should be able to help guide you to make sure that all the requirements are set. So, for example, the parties all have to be over the age of 21. The gestational surrogate has to have already had a child of her own. The child has to be genetically related to at least one of the intended parents, but certainly not both. And the child cannot be related to the gestational surrogate. So if you are working with an embryo donor, or if you're pursuing traditional surrogacy, it doesn't necessarily mean it can't happen in Illinois, but it certainly can't happen under this somewhat easy to use statute we have. Our statute also requires that all the parties have independent legal representation, that they've all met with a mental health professional, and that they've all met with a physician. And the reason for all these requirements is really to protect everybody in the process, to make sure everybody knows that they're making an informed decision and understand what their responsibilities are and what their rights are going into the process. The other nice thing about Illinois law is there's no residency requirements, so really nobody has to live in Illinois. The intended parents don't, and the surrogate doesn't. However, the birth must occur in Illinois. So, you know, I often do get calls from clients saying, oh, we're matched with someone in North Dakota and she's great and we're just gonna have her deliver in Illinois. And it all, you know, the beginning of the process, it sounds like, okay, well, but, you know, I think the reality is that's very complicated, and there are a lot of other states out there that also have surrogacy-friendly laws. They just go about them in a bit of a different way. There's no marriage requirement, and so even if you are an unmarried same-sex or opposite-sex couple, if you are doing surrogacy, you can get both of your names on the birth certificate. And I'm having a breakout session this afternoon at 3:20 where we can talk a little bit more about Illinois law, but I also, for a lot of clients, still recommend step-parent adoption or a co-parent adoption just to, you know, further protect you should you be in another state, complicated issues. But I hope you'll all come by and we can talk more then. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Next is Cindy Wasser, who comes from Canada. In Canada, I remember that medical care and medical insurance is less of a headache there than it is here, I can tell you that. But Cindy, if you can concentrate a little bit on the legal considerations up there in Canada, and maybe talk about some insurance and issues and security, securing paternity rights in Canada compare to here and what the process is up there.
Hello, Chicago. It's so great to be here. We are in Toronto, your twin city. So although technically we are international, I do feel like I belong a little bit. We have a lot of similarities in the surrogacy field as well. Canada is a country that is exceptionally tolerant to all people. We have constitutional rights that are protected and grow day by day. gay marriage was something recognized by our federal government several years ago without being forced by a court. And the legal right to parent has been endorsed by our Supreme Court of Canada. We welcome foreigners, and we have been seeing an influx of foreigners over the last few years, partially because we have less restrictive embryo transfer rules. And some of our clinics, such as CREATE, that is here today, also have less restrictive rules with respect to the quarantine of sperm. Similarly, we have rules with respect to ethical considerations in the law. We only have one piece of legislation, however, that covers this across the country. And the only legal rules in that piece of legislation say that a donor must be 18 and a surrogate must be 21. There is a myth out there that says surrogacy and egg donation is a criminal offense or illegal in Canada. It is a myth. What is illegal is payment. What is perfectly legal is reimbursement. Reimbursement has never been defined, so it's important to have a legal advisor who is pretty good at spinning. And we also take very good care of a woman's health in Canada. We have universal health care. So your surrogate will be covered by the provincial medical plan where she resides for all of her medical appointments when she leaves the clinic. So from 12 weeks on, usually they're transferred to the OB or gynecologist or family doctor. All of her health care is covered. While at the fertility clinic, the post-transfer care will be covered as well. So you'll only be paying for the private services of the screening and transfer and donation. The biggest issue is insurance care for the newborn. So each province has its own health plan, and residents are entitled to an automatic 3 months in most provinces of free medical care to allow parents to register their births and then get the formal care. You must be a resident, and that applies in most provinces. In Ontario, about 2 years ago, the medical plan stopped paying for the medical care of newborns who belong to foreigners because they won't be residents. Currently, Alberta and British Columbia are paying, so most foreigners choose to go there for that reason. Insurance plans are being developed as we speak. Some of our foreign clients are working with a company out of Dublin. The cost is probably workable given the other considerations you have for coming to Canada, such as the dollar. And we also recommend that you reduce the risk by single embryo transfer, because the insurance plans we're looking at only apply if you do a single embryo transfer. So we really don't recommend twins. You could go to Alberta and BC if you're intent on having twins, but we can't promise that the healthcare regulations won't change overnight. They don't require legislative change. We take care of our women too in Canada. They have the right to control their bodies throughout the country. So we highly recommend a good surrogacy or egg donation agreement that takes care of her to make sure that she does comply, that you get your eggs, that you get your baby, and that she doesn't terminate without telling you, or that she does terminate at your request.
Thank you very much, very comprehensive. It's very different, but it's very much the same from what I can see.
Yeah, if I could just say, I did a 9-page thing that's very detailed at the CREATE table if you want to get it later.
Now we'll turn out to the medical aspects. I know I discussed a lot, maybe too much, about the medical aspects of in vitro egg donations, screening, surrogates. So I'm going to ask our two experts here, Dr. Klipstein and Dr. Pinho. So Dr. Klipstein, if you can just discuss a little bit about this process, egg donation, screening of the sperm source for the donors, and screening of the egg donors, and also talk about evaluating the embryos, the blastocysts, and discuss a few things I may have not said about PGS.
Okay, so 7 minutes, I can talk really fast. So
when done correctly, the medical aspects of this whole process for fathers should be relatively simple and straightforward, and all of the hard lifting should be done by the physicians and the teams behind the scenes. What really enters into the complexity is all of the decision making. There's so many decisions that have to be made that are critical to your futures, and that's where the difficulty comes in. So I just wanted to talk about it from kind of a decision standpoint. So of course, you need to select an egg donor, and this is the first decision that you'll make. This is going to be the genetics that influence your future. So you can use a known donor, and a known egg donor, there are lots of reasons why this might make sense. You can have a genetic connection. Now that only works, obviously, if one of you is donating sperm and the other partner is using a known genetic relative. It might not be a related person. It might be someone that you know and trust, your best friend, a non-related family member. And that's good because you know their personality, you know their medical history, you know their quirks, you really have a lot of sense about that. And maybe you trust them to genetically contribute to your family. The reasons against is that the relationship, for better or worse, is always there. You're going to know the relationship, the egg donor will know about it, and then there's issues of disclosure. Are you going to tell your kids about it? Who else is going to know? And this person may always be in your life, and so it's just something to think about. Many people, for these reasons, use anonymous donors, and it's a little bit easier, and this is the most common option that we see. Neither the donor or the recipient have insight into one another's identities, although you do know a whole lot about the egg donor. You'll know her height, her weight, you'll see pictures of her, you'll know her medical background, she'll have a psychological evaluation, genetic evaluation, but she won't have any contact with her. Donor agencies that do it well are very highly selective, so that the donor that is ultimately chosen will have a very good chance of fulfilling your dreams to have a baby. With a known donor, if you choose to go that route, you should make sure that that donor, your friend, relative, be screened exactly how an anonymous donor would be screened under the same criteria, and that the center that's screening her is very honest with you, because sometimes it's hard to say no to someone that you know, but you need to consider that. How are the egg donors screened? Like I said, you can't screen for everything. The family history is very critical. If they have a strong family history of cancer or heart disease or something like that, obviously you would never see them because they would not be accepted. However, a donor that says to me, I have nothing in my family history, you kind of worry about that even more sometimes. And we have to remember that, you know, when we choose our partners in life, we don't ask if your grandmother died of heart disease or what happened, and nobody's perfect, so everybody's going to have something, but you really want to make sure that you get the healthiest egg donor possible. They all go through psychological evaluation. And then the most important part, from my perspective as a fertility doctor, is the medical evaluation. So the egg donor goes through blood tests, ultrasounds. Really, the most important thing in that part of it is to make sure that she has high-quality eggs that will fertilize well and lead to pregnancy, and maybe more than one, ideally. So now, what about the screening of the intended fathers? Of course, one of the first things you may want to consider doing is coming in for a semen analysis. We look at count, we look at movement of the sperm, we look at all kinds of things. Fortunately, since in the majority of cases the process involves in vitro fertilization, where the egg and sperm are fertilized outside of the body, you need very little sperm, and even if there are issues with sperm, most of the time we can overcome them. But even if you don't know which of you is going to be the genetic parent, sometimes it's worth testing both. Sometimes both of you will want to be the genetic parent, but you kind of want to do this maybe up front. It's fairly easy to do, and then you at least know what you're dealing with moving forward. In most cases, everything will be fine, but that's information I would want at the start of the process. Now, the other question then that you need to make is, how do you fertilize those eggs? And there are lots of options. You can choose to have one baby where only one of you is the sperm donor, and the egg donor is anonymous. You can choose to, in some cases, although there are some implications, the lawyers will tell you this may not be a good idea, but you can mix the sperm together and then fertilize the eggs with this sperm mixture, in which case you may not want to know who the genetic father is. And certainly what I've seen in many cases is that people want twins, and so you'll split the donor eggs in half, and half of the eggs will be fertilized with sperm from one of you, half from the other, and then you either transfer one embryo at a time, intending having one baby now and one baby later, or sometimes you transfer two with the intention of having twins. However, if you transfer two of these embryos and only one takes, you won't know for a while whose genetics are in that baby. Maybe you can tell by how the baby looks like at birth, but in any case. And then the final thing is, what about screening of the embryos? So reproduction is not perfect, and even when you are in the best of situations, you use a very young woman
whose eggs are very high quality, about a third of the embryos that are created will not be normal. And what do I mean by normal? That each cell in each of our bodies and also in the embryos should have 46 chromosomes. If you have too many or too few, oftentimes that leads to no pregnancy or a pregnancy that miscarries early on. More rarely, you can have problems like Down syndrome. But there's a nice technology, and as you alluded, it's not perfect, but very nice technology, where you can screen the embryos, and you don't have a 100% guarantee, but the chance of success if you screen the embryos with genetics is much higher. So transferring one embryo in general that's screened is just as successful as transferring two unscreened. I will tell you that when we transfer two screened embryos at the same time, the risk or the chance of twins is much higher than 50%, and you know, I'd say approaches 75 or 80% twins. So a very likely chance of success, but also you have to think about if you're screening the embryos, perhaps just transferring one. And so just kind of a typical cycle might look like this, that the two intended fathers come meet with a physician, the sperm parameters are evaluated, then they select the egg donor and the surrogate, and I think you'll be speaking, I don't want to steal the thunder about the surrogate selection, and then the egg donor undergoes an egg retrieval. The intended genetic father or fathers either come at the time of the donor's egg retrieval to the clinic to produce sperm, or it's very easy to freeze sperm in advance, so you don't actually have to come for this part of the process. And then the embryos that result can be screened genetically, and then they're transferred into the surrogate. And I will tell you that the most difficult part of this process, even though it seems like you've already done everything and you're just waiting, is the 10 days where you wait and find out if the surrogate is pregnant. It's the hardest thing. You're doing nothing. You're sitting and you're waiting. I think it's the longest 10 days of everybody's life. And hopefully at the end of it, you get a very nice phone call from the fertility center congratulating you. So I'll end with that, and I'm open to questions at the end.
Thank you very much. And yes, it is a very difficult wait. Dr. DePinho is here from CT, Connecticut Fertility Associates. Thank you for being here.
I'm going to try to see if I can come. I'll just stand up a little bit so I can go through the slides. So basically, there is two options on surrogacy that you will have immediately. First is, who is the surrogate? And for that, you will have agencies that you can go through. There is a process where it can be done also in a clinic, and it depends highly on the other options that I will talk about. So the process of opting for a surrogate, it's not mathematically given that you're going to look at someone and just say, I'm picking that person because it's the right person that I think it would be. A little bit different than a donor where the profile counts a little bit more. The other thing is, are you going to match it before of your cycle or after your cycle, or after you choose the donor or not? And that can be a little bit tricky, and that means that there will be a coordination between the agencies themselves and basically what you will have with the clinic that is surveilling these patients. Now, I'm sorry about the font that went a little bit different. The requirements are going to be pretty much the same as my colleague has stated over here. We want to know if it's a healthy person, especially here it will count, of course, as expected, the pregnancy history. So knowing how they did in the cycle before, where you know they had a match and everything went fine, it's one thing than having, for example, a birth history that has complications, and we have to screen those very well. There is a screening for all the diseases as donors usually go through. It depends highly a little bit on the clinic. It's important to know the surrogacy history. Here differently, different clinics do different things, or agencies will scout not only the history for the patient itself, but also for the family that surrounds that patient, if it's a good environment. The social history is also something extremely important. The medical risks of something like choosing a surrogate, it's not so much about the surrogate, it's about the options that you make once you decide, and that I will pick up on, which is how many are you going to transfer? And so one of the first things that you have to realize is that importantly is if you have one, there is a possibility of splitting and still having a pregnancy that will be a twin pregnancy. But if you're transplanting two or transferring two, and they are both implant, then you might have an incur risk. And so twin pregnancies, and I want to make this very clear because I think it's important for the information process. It is the information on the counseling, not only to the surrogate, but also to the prospect parents. Reason being is that it is a complicated pregnancy, a twin pregnancy, not even speaking about triplets in higher order, which will be even worse. And my dear colleague and esteemed colleague over here will have to surveil them in their MFM department. The risk of the preterm delivery, the risk of prematurity, the risk for the children themselves, which have beautiful screening, no problems whatsoever, and now you all of a sudden are left with a birth at prior to 30 weeks when if you have waited a little bit longer, I know it's a monetary cost, and it all depends on the balance. There is no right answer, by the way. You will not have a right answer. You will just have an assumption that everybody knows once things happen so that you're prepared for them. The other thing is preparing. It's not only anticipating, but also organizing per profile of the surrogate. If the surrogate depends on the age of the surrogate, if the complications for a twin pregnancy can be related, for example, to high blood pressure, and that will be costly to the patient and consequences. There is miscarriage rates also higher for twin pregnancy. What are you going to do? Are you going to use the same surrogate? What's your relationship going to be with the surrogate? And so those intricate points, which don't seem medical initially, they are because they start as, but then if you don't have a background of starting them off by having that conversation with you and then having that conversation with the surrogate, it might be a miss and it might be actually very resolvable. My last point, which we talked and covered most of it, is it should be an enjoyable process. But, and you should anticipate that there are always going to be complications. The first person that comes to you and sits down with you, medical or non-medical, it doesn't matter, and says, I'm going to take care of you and everything is going to be smooth, nothing is going to happen, please choose somebody different. Because complications do happen, hopefully it won't be for any of you, but you want to have a good coordination of team, regardless if it's an agency or a clinic, that will have a very good communication so that everything gets back to you, which, like I talked before, you're the epicenter of everything. Not only the surrogate, not only the donor, but you are. And it's devastating news when a couple has made a decision that they're not prepared for. And so we'll be able to help. I'll have also consultations if you want and have any questions afterwards. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, everybody. Just one thing about twins again, is that in the process of surrogacy, even if the surrogate had a perfect pregnancy and she delivered nicely, vaginally, never had any C-section, and your egg donor is perfect on paper, it's kind of a shot in the dark. Usually things go well if things have been well for the surrogate. Usually things go well when the egg donor is healthy and genetic history is known, but you can't promise that. The only thing you can guarantee in the whole process, almost guarantee, because it's about 1% chance that the egg will split into twins if you transfer one. But you can pretty much be guaranteed you'll have only one baby if you transfer one. And there's such a good chance of having two if you transfer two. That's the only thing you can control, guys. So keep that in mind. I think this is, we may have a few minutes for questions, if you guys have any.
Yes, yes to both, and I think that's an important point for whatever state you're in. A birth certificate for all practical purposes will, you know, enable you to do almost anything you want with your child, you know, enroll in school, get your health insurance, but it's not the same thing as an underlying order stating that they're that you are both the parents, because that will be given full faith and credit, and it will be recognized in every state. And it would be the non-biological parent that would need to, you do it together, but that would need to do the step-parent adoption. Mm-hmm. And that's a really important point, and I do think a lot of couples opt not to take that extra step because you've been through so much, and in Illinois it's so nice that nothing can change the fact that both of your names will go on the birth certificate as long as you, you know, follow our strict requirements. But it's still a really important piece, in my opinion, because another state could not recognize our statute, even though they have to recognize your marriage. And even if you're married, we're not really sure what's going to happen in light of the Supreme Court decision. I'm hopeful that someday in the future I'll feel comfortable advising you that you don't need to take that extra step, but at this point I'm still advising that that's a good idea, important idea.
Any other questions? Yes. I'll repeat the question. It pertains to a fresh versus frozen cycle.
So there are two things to consider, whether you're talking about using a fresh or frozen egg or a fresh or frozen embryo. So the easiest way to do this is to pick your egg donor, do the cycle, freeze the embryos, and then kind of think about the surrogate later. Whether you use a fresh embryo or a frozen embryo actually makes no difference at all. In fact, there's some data to suggest that frozen embryos may be better, it makes no difference. In a lab that knows how to freeze well, and most of the IVF labs in the country today do, it doesn't make any difference. With the egg freezing, you need to, do you want to, you know what, why don't you talk about it?
That's something you've approached very little, it's egg freezing, because it was a topic which was not even on at the table 10 years ago, but as much as embryos freeze and thaw much more easily than eggs, and now eggs, where are we at with egg freezing?
So the official data is that there's still no consensus on the cryopreservation or freezing of eggs. But the preliminary data for some groups that have been putting the data out there with two different methods. So the old method was with a slow freezing. Basically, the new method is a decline in so fast that we call vitrification, becomes less. Besides of the technical terms, it is much easier to do this in an embryo because it does not have only one cell, but it has a whole array of cells. By the time that they get frozen, they have 200 plus cells, and they're already all well organized. So if they get a hit maybe of one, two cells with the freezing process, it's not the same as the egg. But the short answer is, it is much better. It used to be 1 to 35, according to ESHRE, is the organization for Europe, put it some data out there a few years ago. You would get one pregnancy out of 35 eggs, and this is with slow freezing. With the new data, and I'll be very sparsely in trying to not pull numbers because excitement from people that hear, then it might not translate because it depends on many things, the donor, the age of the donor, the quality, the staff that freezes, and my colleague referred that very well, you have to have a very good team. But according to new data, it can be 1 in 10 to 12 to give you a pregnancy. I'm pretty sure that there are people that are saying even lower numbers than this. What I can advise is take a look at the experience of the center. There is SART data that I actually wanted to talk about, but I didn't want the presentation to be too long. SART data will give you a look back for that clinic on terms of your freezing history on fresh and frozen cycles, a little bit on a lagging of 2 years. So it's kind of a good window at least to start with. And then ask questions. Don't be afraid to ask a question because you think that, you know, it's going to be not answerable by the physician. Ask, how do you freeze? What are your rates? What are going to be your rates according to last year? Because I don't see that in SART. And those are the questions. It seems to be a little bit aggressive, don't mind the aggressiveness. Don't bank anything on the eggs themselves, because it might be the technology will advance, and we sure will, but be cautious before that technology advances and where you use that technology, in which center are you going to use it. I don't know if you want to have anything.
I have a quick question pertaining to the wait period, which is, you know, none of our pregnancies, we have two kids, were successful in the first try. We had to try a few times for each of the kids, so obviously they were all frozen cycle, but ultimately successful. I think psychologically, when you wait for this pregnancy result, is going to work or not work, it would be better psychologically in the mindset, like, okay, my goal is to be pregnant within 6 to 8 months, or whatever, a few cycles, not, okay, my goal is to be pregnant after this cycle, and then be devastated each time, because it's devastating. So when are some clinics or some contracts going to have kind of a baby guarantee with a single embryo transfer, like no matter how many tries, because you know that in the end, the good news is that almost all of us are successful. And years, the stories of my failures, like it's, I forgot that a long time ago. And I tell myself that if these babies had worked on the first try, I wouldn't have the ones that I have now, which are so wonderful. So where are we with that contract?
Yeah, no, it's a good point, because I always tell people, you know, when you have your babies, you're not going to have any of, you can't imagine having any other babies than the babies you have, and they're going to be the right babies for you. You don't know that when you get the negative pregnancy test and you're devastated. We do have what we call shared success contracts, where you know, we use them where we guarantee you up to however many cycles, and if you don't get pregnant, then you get, you know, your money back. It's a nice thing, but it's just as nice to have embryos frozen, which is essentially achieving the same thing. The nice thing there is that it is a process, it is a journey, and we all talk about that. And if you have in your mind, you know, this batch of embryos is going to lead to a baby, I don't know if it's today, I don't know if it's in 3 months, but have it. I always like to tell people, like, kind of have a backup plan, give it 2 cycles. Hopefully it'll work the first, but have in your mind that you're giving yourself 2, just so that you can psychologically protect yourself a little bit. Because you don't want to have kind of all your eggs in one basket. I know it's a bad phrase to use, but literally, you know, sometimes it takes a little time. It doesn't mean it won't work. And sometimes people say, well, it didn't work the first time. Why won't it work the second time? There's a very high chance of success, especially if it doesn't work the first time. You know everything. You know what's going on. You know how to optimize things, that it will work within 2 times. Again, our goal is always to try to do everything possible to obtain a pregnancy with the very first attempt. But a little bit of patience and a little bit of, I think, psychological protection is always warranted.
Yes, Vicky?
I just want to jump in on the surrogacy program side on that, because it is really important, and I tell clients this all the time, that you're at the mercy of Mother Nature. And again, like the doctors were saying, keep the vision in mind, you know, visualize the positive, visualize that you will have your baby. But sometimes the first surrogate doesn't work. Sometimes, I mean, we've had situations where a surrogate will go through the medical treatment, the medications, and her uterine lining won't develop the way it's supposed to. And then they try again, and she's perfect in every way, but it doesn't work again. And then the doctor says, we need to try a new surrogate. So then you're coming back to us and saying, well, now what? And we're saying, okay, we'll find you another surrogate. You know, we will do this for you. We will stay with you. We are committed to you. But you have to stay committed to your process and to the vision of having your family. Sometimes there's a miscarriage. That happens to, and in fact, with straight couples that come to surrogacy, a lot of them have been through a lot of infertility issues already, so they're kind of like, you know, realistic about the Mother Nature things. But if you haven't been, you're a gay couple, you haven't been through infertility or miscarriages or that, so you're thinking, well, I can get pregnant, or I will have twins. You have to realize that there are hurdles that you may have to get over. If there's a miscarriage, you're going to be completely devastated like anybody would be, but you're going to try again, and you might try with the same surrogate, or we might get you another surrogate. But again, always stay true to the vision, because it might, and some of you may get pregnant the first time. It does happen, and some of you may have a single baby or twins or have another baby, but again, you have to stay positive, stay true to your vision to have your baby, and you'll have your family.
Thank you, Vicky. And we'll end on this. We have to remember, I'm sorry, we don't have time for any more questions, but we'll be available for personal questions, individual questions. Keep in mind that there's still a lot of unknown out there, even for physicians, hopefully not for lawyers. But when it comes to surrogacy, we tried surrogacy for the second journey with the same surrogate. And after a few tries, it didn't work. And we had to switch surrogate, like Vicky said, and it worked the first time. So why? We still don't know, right? The surrogate worked our first journey without any problems very easily, and it didn't the second time. Medically speaking, I cannot explain to you why, and I'm sure these physicians here can't either. So thank you very much.
Thank you to all of the expert panelists. We really appreciate your insights, and thank you. And I imagine all of them are going to be available at the expo, and many are having breakout sessions that you can actually speak with them individually and ask more individualized questions.